you coming?
I'm not gonna mention it. It's his birthday. Alright, we're live. We're going. See, that's really Paul Stanley. Watch this. It's not Paul.
I said the joint was rocking, going round and round. Crazy sound, and they never stopped rocking till the moon went down. Well, it sounds so sweet, I had to take me a chance. Rose out of my seat, I just had to dance. Started moving my feet, oh, the clap of my hands. I said the joint was rocking, going round. Suspect. And when the police knocked, those doors flew back, but they kept on rocking.
Showtime.
Good evening, everybody, and welcome to Friday Night Vinyl. As always, Friday Night Vinyl is brought to you by Red Solo Cup and the magic contained within.
But Ed, I have a new cup for this week, Ed. I got the Black Mug Cup.
The Mystery Black Mug Cup.
That says there's a chance this is vodka.
There is a chance.
There's a chance there's
a
vodka.
A slight chance. Well, that reminds me here. I got a letter this week from Katie from Kalamazoo, Kentucky.
Oh, wow. Yes. One of our fans.
Well, she said, Ed, every week you're wobbling the Red Solo Cup like there's nothing in it.
Which is correct.
And I would just like to explain, Katie, and thank you for watching from Kalamazoo, Kentucky, if that even exists, is the fact that early on when I was doing setup one time, I had a drink in a Red Solo Cup and it cracked and it fortunately just went on the floor. There's too many electronic stuff going on over here, and so I always keep my Red Solo Cup empty. But
you never take a sip of beer and it goes on the keyboards, right?
Never happens.
Never happens, right?
Yes, it happened about 2 minutes before the show started. I had to turn it upside down. I didn't want to rub the keyboards, because if I did,
shaking the keyboard out right before the show started.
I was like like yes. doing this because I don't want to rub it and have it press a button that alters and does something goofy and all this. So, one thing on last week's show, and we're working on it, there still may be a little tiny bit of static tonight. We think we have everything because we have a new microphone. It's over here. I'm not going to move it because
that might be from the plate in your head.
It could be the plate in my head from the war.
Right.
So this year we're talking about 1979. A lot of good things happened in 1979. I graduated from high school in 1979. I am the class of 1979.
That was an amazing thing that happened, that you actually did graduate.
The funny thing is this, though, is I am the class of 79, and most people would say, I am the class of 1979.
Oh, we get it. Yeah, the class. Okay.
Class, you know, get it. Pinky out. Hey.
Oh, yeah, okay, yeah.
Class. So I see Vinny Bonafangucci is here. I see Ben Powell is here. Bob Young, thank you for watching.
Vinny says he has a feeling there's going to be an argument tonight. Vinny, there's an argument every Friday night.
Ken, Paul, anybody else, if you're lurking out there, just say hi and just say where you're from. Just cool to see where some people are just checking in to watch the show. So one of the things we usually do, and we didn't last week, is...
What did we not do?
Well, usually... Because when the show's going, we can't see every comment. We usually go back on, you know, the next day and watch the comments.
Right, yes.
And the next day was a lot of football, and it just didn't happen. But I promise this week again, I'll go back and look at the comments, because if we don't answer your comments here, I'll go back and I will tell you that I'm right. Lenny will somehow, because he stalks me on the internet, will come in and tell me that I'm wrong and that he's right. So
exactly.
Anyway, so... I don't know. Is there anything?
So what do we got?
Anything else in the wrap up here? Other we get to?
No, I think we should just get to this day in music and start the show.
Sounds good to me.
Everyone, welcome to This Day in Rock History. We're going to start, today is January 26th, by the way. In 1956, Buddy Holly and the Two Tunes recorded their first tracks for Decca Records in Nashville. Backing Buddy on the four songs are Grady Martin on guitar and Doug Kirkham on the drums. Are you familiar with those two, Ed? I'm not...
Buddy Martin or Kirkham?
Yeah, Doug Kirkham. Kirkham on drums and Grady Martin on guitar.
Not at all.
No, I don't. I thought maybe they were notables because they were mentioned.
That's Buddy Holly, you said.
Yeah, Buddy Holly.
The famous one was the one that lived because he lost. He won the coin flip, and his grandson was. This was on
his four song when he recorded. I guess a demo or something. They were the two people who were playing on the demo for him. So I don't. I wasn't familiar with him. I thought maybe you were.
Not all the news.
Oh my God. Okay. So January 26th. 1962, Bishop Burke of the Buffalo, New York Catholic Diocese. Yeah, but
and we're off.
And we're off.
Do a shot.
Okay, we'll call it the Catholic Church. They banned the twist. They banned the twist in any form from all school functions back in 1962, January 26th.
Wow.
I guess it was a little too risque back then. 1963, January 26th, The Four Seasons, Walk Like a Man is released. 5 weeks later, it will become their third Billboard number one single.
Wow.
5 weeks later, yeah. Third one. I wonder what the other two are. So anyway... Yeah,
probably Sherry.
Oh, okay.
And Big Girls Don't Cry.
Big Girls Don't Cry, okay. 1963, January 26th, a trio called the Rooftop Singers took Walk Right In.
Feel at Home.
Yeah.
Mama, da-da-da-da-da.
That topped the Billboard charts on January 26, 1963. The song had been written in 1930 by a guy called Gus Cannon, who had been living in poverty until he started earning royalties from that hit record in 1963. He was living in poverty.
Wow.
He wrote that in the 30s. Wow.
Interesting.
Yeah, that is very interesting. January 26, 1974, Ringo Starr went to number one on the Billboard single charts with his version of Johnny... Burnett's 1960 number 8 hit, You're 16, You're Beautiful, and You're Mine. Woo.
Oh, maybe we should stop the show now.
Now the track, Ed, did you know the track featured Paul McCartney on Gazoo?
No, I did not.
And Harry Nilsson was on backing vocals.
Nilsson, yes.
Nilsson, excuse me. You gotta forgive me with the pronunciations.
I was wondering, in all these
Which
years,
Paul McCartney
all
playing
these
a Gazoo?
Years, no, all these years of wonderment, I was wondering, who the hell was the Gazoo player on Ringo Starr's Your 16?
Well, now you know, it's Paul McCartney.
Life is good.
Isn't it? Learn something new every day. January 26, 1977, as the punk music movement continues to grow, Ed, the Clash signed a $100,000 contract with CBS Records, a remarkable amount for a band that just played a total of about 30 gigs and very few as a headliner. And they got paid that much money.
That's very interesting.
The Clash.
You're up, you're down.
Down, I'm over here.
You're all over the place, man.
Okay, 1980, January 26, 3 years after signing with Warner Brothers, 21-year-old Prince makes his U.S. television debut on American Bandstand, where he performs his R&B chart-topping hit, I Want to Be Your Lover. That was in 1980, January 26th. In 2007, January 26th, we got some, I guess there's the death notices here. Tommy D, who reached number 11 on the Billboard charts in 1959 with 3 stars. A song that was dedicated to Ritchie Valens, Buddy Holly, and the Big Bopper. He died at the age of 70 after a long illness. January 26, Michael Jackson returned to the United States after living in France and Ireland for more than a year after a self-imposed exile after filing his acquittal in a high-profile child molestation trial that ended in June of 2005. January 26, 2011, Gladys Horton, whose lead vocals helped the Marvelettes establish their career with such hits as Mr. Postman, Playboy, and Beachwood 45789, died following a stroke at age of 66. And in 2013, January 26, the Ohio Players frontman Leroy Sugarfoot Bonner died of an unknown cause at the age of 69. He led the group to the top of the Hot 100 with Fire in 1974 and Love Roller Coaster in 1975.
Roller Coaster.
Love Roller Coaster.
Love.
Say what?
Yeah.
And that does it for this week.
No, it does not.
You've got more.
There are a couple things that you missed there, my friend.
Okay.
Today, and if I missed you saying it, because I was just letting it go in one ear and out, then correct
me. Like you usually do.
Yes, but on 1986 on this day, Alan Collins, guitarist from Lynyrd Skynyrd, crashed his car, paralyzing him from the waist down and killing his girlfriend.
That's not good.
It's just a shame that there's the bad luck that just
follows that group. Yeah.
Also, following the car crash, Billy Joel in 2003 was airlifted to the hospital after he crashed his car into the tree.
Seems a recurring theme with these artists, Ed.
Yes.
They like to crash their cars.
Now, here's one that I found interesting. Queen had their second number one UK hit with a song called Innuendo. At 6 minutes and 30 seconds, it exceeded Bohemian Rhapsody by 35 seconds
and
became the third longest UK number one single of all time, behind the Beatles' Hey Jude and Simple Minds' Belfast Child. And so that, and I think you missed a big birthday today.
Okay.
Andrew Ridley, one half of Wham. Born on this day. Think you missed another big birthday. Anita Baker was born on this day.
Okay.
But, oh my God, I should come over there and smack you right now. You've missed. Today is Eddie Van Halen's birthday.
Oh my God. How can I miss that?
And you're not going to believe this. Also, Rob McGee, Aaron Spieth.
It's his birthday?
It is Rob McGee's birthday. So, hey, send him flowers. Send him love. I'm going to send him about 5,000 CDs back.
Sounds good.
So, anyway, I think that wraps up the news.
Let's wrap it up.
Hey everybody, the Super Bowl's another week away. Looking forward to it.
Yes.
And as we were researching albums in 1979, we found two interesting albums. One of them Lenny pointed out to me.
Right.
And it's like,
Look at this. This is kind of interesting.
Yeah, and I didn't realize this album came out in 79. And do you want to let them know? Okay, so there was a group called New England.
They
came out with their debut album in 1979. And Ed, I know you know this, it was produced by Kiss's Paul Stanley.
Yes, as opposed to Aerosmith's Paul Stanley.
Paul Stanley, yeah. And you have this album, by the way.
Yes, I do.
So don't laugh.
I do?
Yes, you do have it, and I love the way you're so prepared. There you go.
I do have it. Well,
hey, yeah, that matches the picture.
This is a live show.
There you go. That matches the picture that you have here. That's,
yes, it does.
Yes, it does. Look at that. Wow.
So anyway.
And then, as we were doing our consensus top 10, we noticed that another group called the Eagles.
The Eagles.
The Eagles have album The Long Run came out in 1979. So we thought that, hey, let's pit together the Eagles and New England album.
And New England.
And do a showdown.
And we'll see who wins.
Yeah. Let's try it.
To me, this is going to probably be a telling of, the Super Bowl.
Right. So, Ed, I guess I'll start. I'll take the Eagles.
Yeah, and I'm not really taking New England. I'm just stating some facts. I'm going to see where they go.
Well, Ed, the Eagles have it. The Eagles have a song called The Long Run, which Jay Ajayi is going to do to the New England and, Blunt and whoever else and Clemens and all them guys. They're going to have a lot of long runs in the Super Bowl against New England.
Nice. Well, do you know, New England has a song on this album called Nothing to Fear. But I'm thinking to myself, they should have the Eagles.
Yes. You know, and the Eagles also, on the long run, the Eagles have a song called I Can't Tell You Why. As in, I can't tell you why the Eagles are going to win, but they will.
I agree with you. Now, New England, to counter that, has a song called Don't Ever Want to Lose You. Well, they're going to lose.
They're going to lose.
Yeah.
Yes. The Eagles, on the other hand, have a song called In the City. Now the Eagles play in the city of Philadelphia. Where the hell does New England play? Do they even play in a city or even a state?
I know, Foxborough.
Really? Where the hell is that?
They're not called the Foxborough Patriots.
No.
Now, New England has a song called Shall I Run Away? That would probably be, as Larry David would say, a pretty good idea.
Yeah, especially after the game, after they get blown out, right?
Yes, okay. Absolutely.
Okay, so on the Eagles side, they have a song off this album called Heartache Tonight. There's going to be a heartache tonight in New England after this game.
I definitely agree with you. Now, on the New England album, this album right here, they have a song called Turn Out the Light. And you know what? It's time the dynasty turns out the light and go home.
Yes. And Ed, I have a quiz for you, Ed.
Yeah.
Where are the Patriot fans going to go after the Super Bowl? In fact, there's a song on the Eagles' Long Run album that can be the perfect place to go.
I have no idea.
They're going to the Sad Cafe.
Sad Cafe.
Because they're going to be sad after the game because the Eagles are going to kick their butt.
Wow. And New England has a song called The Last Show, which this will be Tom Brady and Bill Belichick's last show.
Because they ain't going to another one again.
And I think we can conclude this argument with the final thing. The Eagles have Joe fucking Walsh. Boom.
Drop the mic.
Eagles
win in a landslide.
4 million sales to 400 over here.
There you go.
So, I've got to look at some of the comments now, with the exception of Ben Powell. Take a little time out here going through. First off, Scott, we'll see what Lenny says about Supertramp this week. Bill, we're working on the static thing. First off, we shouldn't have... It's a new mic. I think I have everything adjusted. There might be little tiny bits and pieces here. I'm just about figuring it out. I don't think there'll be anything long-term. Not good. Let's see, who else we have here? Vinny goes, have a feeling there's going to be an argument tonight. Vinny, there's an argument every night, Vinny. It's like saying there's the Pope Catholic.
Right.
And let's see who else here. All right, so we got Mike, we got Scott, and Lenny Dramas is there. And Lenny, happy birthday to Lenny Dramas.
Happy birthday, Len.
He turned 63 4 days ago.
Oh, okay.
No. I think he turned 58. Because I think he's only a little bit older than me. So
okay.
Anyway, happy birthday, Lenny. So now we're going to get into our top 10.
All right.
And
this is where it gets interesting.
Here's where the fun always begins. Now, this is our consensus top 10. So yes. This is taking me and Lenny's picks.
Right.
And putting them together and forming
the... And then forming what Ed really likes and throwing out what I really like.
Well,
that's what usually happens. So.
Well, we cannot constantly have... Kiss only had one album this year.
Right.
Okay? Or maybe they had like... But three live albums and four greatest hits things.
Did it get in? I don't know.
Yeah, so we'll see.
Okay.
So, let's start off. So this week, there was a two-way tie for 10th. So we'll go with the first. And there it is.
The Eagles are back again.
The Eagles, the long run. So go ahead, Lenny.
For an encore. Okay, so this came in at number 10 in our consensus. I actually had
We say E-A-G-L-E-S? Eagles!
Okay.
There we go.
So anyway, this came in at number...
I feel so Wayne's World-ish now.
Yeah, right. Okay.
Like, party on, Garth.
Yeah, party on, Wayne. So anyway, this came in at number 10. I had this at number 5. I had this at number 5, Ed. This was a strong album by the Eagles, and this should have been way higher than what actually came in. And, you know, I don't understand. I mean...
Well, go ahead.
Look at these songs that came off this album. The Long Run. I can't tell you why, which was one of my favorite Eagles songs. In the City, The Disco Strangler, Heartache Tonight, Those Shoes. Just those six songs that I mentioned out of the 10. That's six strong songs out of 10 on this album.
Well, this did make my top 10.
Okay.
Whoops.
Well, I had this at number 5.
Yeah, I think I might have had this at number... let's go here. I pull it up here. I had this... Did I? No, I think I...
You didn't even have it in your top 10.
No.
Because it would have made 10 if you had it in your top 10.
True.
How did you leave this out of your top 10? Please.
Well, this is probably my favorite Eagles album, the Eagles album I bought before. But I've got other albums that I liked more.
Like the one that's tied for number 10. I can't wait to address that one.
This is going to be a little bit of a... Believe the vinyl down there. You're going to have to trust me. At the end of the show, I'll show you some things. Some things, not everything. So for me, this is a great album. And what I like on this album, I love In the City. One of my favorites is The Disco Strangler. And another song I love on this album is The Greeks Don't Want No Freaks.
Yeah, it's a decent song.
It's just a stupid song. It's not a top-tier song
for me, but I think there's six solid, like, number one type songs on here.
Marie Halbrich is watching. Hello, Marie. Welcome to the show. Amazing.
And she's so far away.
Yeah,
it's amazing that she can join.
Yes. She's so far away from me. So, let's go to the album that's tied for number 10. This is where people are going to go, what?
Right, I went, what, when I saw it.
Adventures in Utopia. Okay.
Oh, excuse me.
The band is Utopia. It's Todd Rundgren and Utopia, but it's called Utopia.
Right.
Okay.
And
First off, this
was my reaction. Huh?
Okay.
What? Huh?
First off, this is probably one of Todd Rundgren's best albums. To me, this album...
Well, if it is, I hate to listen to the other ones.
Oh, wow. This is a great album.
Ed, I just listened to this today before I came over. I listened to every track, and it's like, eh.
The Road to Utopia. Great song. You Make Me Crazy. I like it. It's a fun song. Second Nature.
That should be the theme of our show. You Make Me Crazy.
Second Nature. Nice song. Was a borderline hit. Set Me Free. Another great song. Caravan. Great song. The Last of the New Wave Riders. I'm telling you. I'm sorry. This is one. Now, let me see where I probably had this. This was at number 5 for me.
Well, I didn't have it at all.
You had the Eagles at number 5.
I had the Eagles at number 5, right.
And I had this at number 5.
And you didn't have... How could you have this at number 5 and the Eagles not in your top 10?
This is just an album for me.
Oh, my God.
Scott, I can only be right 99.9% of the time. Every once in a while. But this is a great album for me. Now, again, we're not sitting here judging what are the greatest albums.
No, we're just judging...
What are our favorite albums?
We're judging your opinion of what the album should be.
Well, you know what? Let's go to number 9.
Of all these great albums of 79, you picked this piece of shit to be in the top 10.
It is not a piece of shit.
Excuse me.
Todd is God.
All right, let's get on to the next one.
The Dream Frickin' Police.
Okay, here's another one I didn't have in my top 10.
Well, you know what? You need to broaden your horizons.
Oh, okay. There's only like two friggin' songs on this whole album that's good. Out of how many? How many came off of here? Nine.
And Dream Police.
How did you have this ranked? You had to have this high if this came in at number nine. I didn't even have this.
This album was at number seven. So this was probably in a points tie with... Yeah.
Okay.
Anyway. The Dream Police, It's the Way of the World. The Gonna Raise Hell is a great...
Yeah, Gonna Raise Hell is it's a little long.
I'll Be With You
song.
Tonight. Voices was one of the hits off of this. No, I'm sorry. It's Cheap Trick.
Scott says, I'm on a roll. Ed, please.
Scott.
Hey.
I will win you back.
No, you
Scott,
won't. No, you won't.
I may be losing you now, but as we progress through the show, I will win. At the end of the show, I guarantee you, Scott says...
So you're like the New England Patriots of our show.
I'm a comeback kid.
You're a comeback kid.
Okay. I am the comeback kid.
All right.
Is that a song by the Eagles?
Could be.
So that's it? You got nothing on this?
I have nothing on it because I didn't pick it. I mean, I told you, there's only two songs that I really like. But I have to say, The House is Rockin' is like a really punky kind of song that I thought, re-listening to this, which surprised me from Cheap Trick. Because, as you say, that they're Beatle-esque. And, you know, whatever.
All right. So number eight. Damn the Torpedoes, Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers. Okay. Ready? Do you have this? Is this in your top
list? Yes,
it
was. This was my number seven, and it came in at number eight.
Okay.
A lot of great songs from Tom Petty. Well, this is Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers, not Tom Petty.
Right.
Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers. Refugee, Here Comes My Girl, Even the Losers, Shadow of a Doubt, Don't Do Me Like That. Really solid, great songs. I mean, that's like half the album right there that are top hits on here. And it's a strong album by him. I mean, I think it's probably one of his best. There's like four songs in here. It could be on his greatest hits album.
Right. If I'm repeating it ad nauseum, that the story about this was, he basically was told by the label, this is it, you're done. And I think he actually he may have even had to take out his own money to help to complete the album for the budget and everything. And the reason the album is called, it's kind of crazy when you think about it. Damn the Torpedoes was really a statement that he was making, saying, you know what, this is it, this is all I got left.
Mm-hmm.
Boom.
Right.
And if this album never got out, if he never did whatever he had to do, we would have lost out on a lot of great music.
Yeah.
And
well, he took a chance on himself and it paid off.
Yes, he did.
On this album. Yeah, definitely.
Sometimes you got to listen to your heart. It'll tell you what
even
to
the
do.
Losers get lucky sometimes.
Even the losers get lucky sometimes, yes. Okay, that's one. Yeah. Yeah. So we'll go to
that's
the next
about
one.
It. Yeah, that one.
Yeah. Regatta de Blanc. Now, for me.
I had this at number 10.
Okay.
In my top 10. You must have had it higher if it came in at number 7.
Yes, I had it at number 4.
Okay.
This is my favorite Police album.
It's a lot of good songs. Well, put it this way. On this album, my favorite Police song is actually on this album, and I think you may agree with me. I know it's one of your top Police songs. Walking on the Moon is off
of
here.
Yes, it is.
It's a dynamite song. Love that song. And I think it's probably my favorite Police song. And they had a lot of hits, you know?
Yeah, so, and that's good. Okay. Yeah.
Message in a Bottle came off of here.
Oh, I think Bill's happy that you could pronounce the Police album.
I didn't pronounce it. You did.
Oh, okay.
I didn't say the Regatta de Blanc. You introduced it. I didn't. So anyway...
Regatta. It's like, that's a cheese, isn't it?
Yeah, Regatta. Regatta de Blanc. Yeah, white cheese.
It is white cheese.
So Message in a Bottle came over here. It's All Right for You. Walking on the Moon. This Bed's Too Big Without You. That's a song that I had forgotten.
Yeah, it's a great song.
Great song. Great song.
Have We Got Contact.
Right. Well, but they're the kind of ones that I like.
So, we saw the Police, I guess, 6 years ago when they reunited. Because I missed them when they were, you know, originally around. And I was so happy to see them live. And the craziest thing was for me, first off, they did play Walking on the Moon, which is, I was like ecstatic. But the song they played that I never ever thought I'd hear in my life was they played Regatta de Blanc.
Mm-hmm.
And the cool thing was the whole Citizens Bank Park, and someone goes, O-U.
Right.
E-A-U.
And they all started.
The whole crowd right. was doing it. It was just so cool. I'm like, I never thought I'd hear that song live.
Right.
You know, that's one of those things like, oh, I never expected to hear that live. So, yeah. Yeah, so that's, let's go to our, next one.
Really ripping through these, aren't we?
We're not ripping through these, but.
So what's our next one, Ed?
Our next one is.
And this is coming in at number 6.
Head Games.
By Foreigner.
No, it's 10, 9, 8, 7, 6. Yes, 6. Yep.
Read the notes.
Yes.
This is coming in at number 6. I had this at number 2, actually, for this year. This is one of my favorite Foreigner albums, or it has to be the favorite Foreigner album for me.
Yeah, not on my top 10.
I know the first two albums are really strong, but there's just something about this album. I just like the song. As a whole, I like this album.
Over time, I like this album more than Foreigner 2.
Okay.
Only because I didn't pay attention to this album.
Right.
And when I paid attention to it for a little bit, but then I went back, and what we're talking about is like when I first got it,
right.
And then like a year or so later,
gotcha.
I went back, I heard Rebel in the Red Line, I'm like,
right.
Oh, that's a great song, oh, it's on this album. Then it made me listen to the rest of the album.
Right.
Because, yeah.
So anyway, Dirty White Boys off of here, Love on the Telephone, which is a favorite of mine, I'll Get Even With You, Head Games, Blinded by Science, Do What You Like is a really, I love that song. And Revel in the Red Line is your favorite, and there's a lot of really good, strong tracks off this album. If you're a Foreigner fan, I mean, you gotta love this. You really have to love this album. I think it's a really, really strong album by them.
Yeah, the.
I mean, as far as 1979 goes, I had this at number 2. That's how much I like this album.
This album grew on me, and again, I have no problem with this album being in the top 10. It's like, I can't argue. I mean, there's a lot of. I mean, the other thing too is like we have to put them in order, and we do this, and it's just lists and everything, and everybody mm-hmm. argues and fights about it,
right.
And that's what you want to see. We're gonna have a celebrity death match later
sure.
in the season,
yes.
In a pit of like you know razor blades or something like that. So let's get to the next one here, which is
people may be surprised we have this here.
Yeah, you know what? Let me look. Yeah, you picked this one too.
Yeah, I had this in my top 10. I had this at number 8. This is Look Sharp by Joe Jackson.
Yeah, Look Sharp by Joe
Jackson.
Anyone
surprised that we actually had this up here this high too? This
yes.
comes in at number 5 for us.
I love this album.
This is really good. Joe Jackson is he's cool. I mean, really. I mean, he's a little nerdy looking, but if you ever saw him any of his live shows, man, he comes over very punky.
Oh,
like very badass kind of.
Did you go see him live?
No, I never saw him. I saw live shows, like broadcast live shows. I never saw them actual live.
Oh, okay. Well, because Lisa, who watches occasionally, mm-hmm. went and saw him live. And he, I think it was maybe at the Man Music Center. And it was on the third album. It was with mm-hmm. that big Dan, whatever it's called. He kind of changed. And he kind of yelled at the audience. It was like pissed. He's like, you guys keep doing this. I'm leaving. Mm-hmm. I heard he was a real asshole at the concert.
His third album?
Yeah, it's...
That was his third. Be Crazy was
yeah.
his third album. He
yeah.
actually came out with two albums in 79.
Yeah.
On the Man
yep.
came later this year, but
yep.
we like Look Sharp better.
So, yeah.
So songs over here, One More Time. Scott, you know, mentioned
yeah,
that song. Yeah, Sunny Papers. One More Time is my favorite off of here. I love it.
There's nothing great.
Yeah, I know. Beautiful. Is She Really Going Out With Him, which was the hit song off of here. Look Sharp, the title track. Got the Time. Now, Ed, you go back. I mean, like I said, like every album that we pick, I go on Spotify and I re-listen to the tracks,
right?
Just to get familiar with everything. It's something that I'm not, you know, I like to re-listen to it. Stuff that I don't remember, stuff that I, you know, just
right.
missed and stuff like that. So anyway, I'm listening to a couple of songs, and you ever listen to a song and you're like, wow, that reminds me of another song?
Yes.
Right. So, I was listening to Fools in Love,
mm-hmm.
and the first song that popped into my mind was Watching the Detectives by Elvis Costello. Just the way the beginning, I don't know if you'd be able to play it or not. But
it's interesting, but
it just reminded me of Watching the Detectives, like in the.
Well, they're both albums from the same year, so.
Right? But it just reminded me of that song, and believe it or not, there's a song on here called "Baby Stick Around," and I was like, the intro, it reminds me of an Alice Cooper song, like the beginning of an Alice Cooper song. And I went back and I remember it was Teenage Lament 74.
Oh, wow, from the Billion Dollar Babies.
Yeah. No, I don't think it was Billion Dollar. I think it was off of Muscle of Love.
Okay.
It was off of Muscle of Love. And it was like just the intro to it. Kind of, I said, this reminds me of like an Alice Cooper song, like just on the intro. So if anybody wants to go, like, you know, just check out those two songs. Joe Jackson's Baby Stick Around, and look up Alice Cooper, Teenage Lament 74, and Fools in Love by Joe Jackson, and listen to Watching the Detectives.
Maybe you can put side by side Spotify on the page.
Yeah, we could probably do that too.
The for me, now I see Scott saying Sunday Papers. Sunday Papers, I love about it. I mean, the bass line in there is like really, it's really great. It's just like, and then, I mean, it's kind of funny, they're both days of the week. Two of the best bass lines from Joe Jackson are Sunday Papers and Friday. Mm-hmm. She, you know, do.
Right,
it's
right.
So yeah, this was just a great album.
Yeah,
it was a fun album.
I missed him live. I really, really wish I got to see him live.
I would like to have seen him on the I'm the Man and not the tour, because Tour de Lisa Soul was the next album.
Okay.
And
I saw some kind of, it was like a BBC network kind of concert where he was doing it in some kind of high school friggin' auditorium or something. And he was doing like songs from the first two albums, maybe it was, or something like that. And he was real punky. Like, he dressed up in the black suit with the thin tie. But he's like real nerdy looking, but he's like, comes off like real, like, you know, like, you know, you're bothering me kind of thing, you know. And the Sunday Papers, he actually had a paper in front of him, and he was paging through it, you know, and he throws it up in the air or something like that, you know, when he was singing that song. It was pretty cool.
Yep. So, let's go to album number 4 on our top 10 list. Van Halen
2.
Van Halen 2.
Van Halen 2.
Which is way better than Van Halen 3.
No, it's way better than, it's better, it's not, I wouldn't say way better, but.
So,
go ahead.
I'm doing a power play here.
Go ahead.
So you understand, I'm not talking about Van Halen's third album.
Right.
I'm talking about Van Halen 3.
Which came out like.
With Gary Cherone.
Which came out in the 90s, right?
So let's just go back. Let's come back to 1979. I'm sorry.
All right.
I time travel for a little bit. We're back.
So I know Van Halen's debut album made number one in our list last week.
Yes.
I think this album is stronger as a whole than Van Halen's first album, to me. I think the songs on here, as a whole, are better than their first album, and I do not know how this did not make it in our top three. I had this album at number one, personally. Even everybody knows what other album came out this year, and everybody's going to say, how can you do that? But I had this album at number one. This is a strong album. There's a lot of great songs on here. You're No Good, Dance the Night Away, Somebody Give Me a Doctor, Bottoms Up, Out of Love Again, Light Up the Sky, DOA, Women in Love, and Beautiful Girls. There is not one bad song on this whole album. Not one bad song. This is a very strong Van Halen album.
Let me know when I can smack your argument down.
Okay. I know there was a couple, there was like two songs I think I didn't care for off the first one. I can't recall. On Fire was one of them that you were arguing. Is that the title off the first album that you thought it was a great song and you played it? And you know, I think even
blow away
I think even Bill,
album.
I think even, yeah, okay. Even Bill Musil even commented and said, you know,
well, you know what you always say to Bill Musil. So.
What do I say?
Fuck Bill Musil. So, anyway,
this is a strong album. This is better than their first album. I don't care what you say. I don't care what you say.
Oh, so
la, la 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 la.
Yeah.
Okay. So go ahead.
Time's mine.
State your case.
Go ahead. All right. I love Van Halen. I love their first album. And I actually really like this album. This album would definitely be in my top 15. It would not be my number one, because the problem with this is when
Wait a minute. You had this in your top 10.
No,
it had
not.
To be. If this came in at number 4, how can you not have it in the top 10?
Because you had it at number 1. Because we had...
You didn't have this in your top 10 for 1979?
Nope.
Oh, my God. See, people, this is what I have to deal with every week. This is why... You know, there's a chance there's Vok in here. Every week there's a chance there's Vok in here.
Here's the thing.
This is the shit I gotta deal with.
I
don't even know why I do the show.
Some of our music horizons are a little bit more like, my roots are in many different directions, where you're kind of like a little plant, a little tiny, like this. No, actually, you know what? Your musical roots are in a cup like this. Mine are more like this. They spread out. They're
okay. So anyway, you're a legend in your own mind, Ed.
Just ask me, I'll tell you.
Just ask it, right.
So anyway, Van Halen 2. Love the album. It's in my top 15. No denial. But for me, when I look at Van Halen 1, I put up here.
And people, wait till you see what came in our top 3, and you're going to be like even more disgusted.
Okay, well, that's what I'm
doing. Because I know what's coming up.
All right.
You don't know yet what's coming up. I know what's coming up.
All right, so Barry Manilow made the top 3. Anyway, so I put Van Halen 1 up here.
I thought it was Donny Osmond.
Don't mess with Donny.
Yeah.
So I put Van Halen 1 at a very high level. Okay, this album was still good. Now, at a Van Halen level, this came in down here as a little more poppy. Now, over time, over history, looking at it now as a full catalog, when Women and Children first came out, that just took the balls that this album is missing and just pumped it up. And we'll get to that album when we get to that.
DOA doesn't have balls.
No, these are good songs.
Bottoms up. Somebody give me a doctor.
Not in my top 10.
Come on.
Not in my top 10.
Somebody give me a doctor.
It's in my top 15. You know what? You might need a doctor. Man. I have another cough drop. So, let's go now to the albums
that didn't make it.
Albums that didn't make it.
Make our top 10, and then we're going to go into our top 3 after that.
Right. So now we're doing albums that didn't make our top 10. Now you're probably wondering, Ed, you don't have any albums. All your albums made the top 10.
Never happened.
Never would happen. But later on, I'm doing a little piece on those albums and a few others that kind of fit the genre. So I didn't want to talk about them here.
You really only had a couple that didn't make it.
I only had two.
So, yeah. And I had one. So
right.
We did pretty well this.
Yes, we did.
Agreeing on stuff.
Yes, we did.
Which is very rare. So, yeah.
And I will tell you this. Cornerstone has one of the most haunting lines on there that haunts me more now.
Oh, is that the album that didn't make it for me? Cornerstone?
Cornerstone.
That's
the only one that didn't make it. For me, it was only two albums, so it's, okay. You know, it's like you don't have to
write. Cornerstone should have been in our top 10, but you know, I don't know how this did not make it in our top 10. I mean, I know, Ed, last week we talked about consecutive albums by Styx, Grand Illusion, I think Pieces of Eight we covered. Well, Grand Illusion we covered back in '77. Pieces of Eight made it in '78. Then Cornerstone, and then they followed that up with Paradise Theater in '81.
Mm-hmm.
So those four consecutive albums were really strong albums by Styx. But out of those four, I will admit that Cornerstone I think is the weakest of the four.
Okay, I'm glad you said that.
They are the weakest of those four, but right. I think as far as 1979 goes, I think they should have made it in the top 10. I mean, this is a little more mellow than a Styx album. Like there's a lot of mellow songs. They have, let me go over some of the tracks on this. They mm-hmm. had Lights, Why Me, Babe was a really big hit for them. That was a slow song. Boat on a River was off of here, Borrow Time. There's a song called Eddie on here. Ed.
Shouldn't every band have a song
called
Eddie?
Right, so all the more reason that this should have made it in our top 10. And
Are You Ready, Eddie, is by Emerson, Lake & Palmer.
There's another song called First Time. And also, now the last track on this album is called Love in the Midnight. And I was like, well, you know what? I re-listened to this album. I was like, I'm not familiar with that. I played this song. Oh, my God. That was a great song. Tommy Shaw did the lead on that.
Bingo.
I know, but it's a really, really good song that I had forgotten about. You know, it's like it's a 5-minute and 25-second song, Tommy Shaw. But anyway, as a whole, Never Say Never is the weakest on here. But, I mean, as a whole, it has a really lot of good songs. But like I said again, and it's kind of soft, a little more mellow for the Styx album mm-hmm. that came out before mm-hmm. and the one after. But I still think, based on the albums that came out in '79, I think this should have made it in our top 10. That's my opinion.
For me, I'm just going to look at your track listings for your album here. For me, I mean, yeah, Babe was a good song when it first came out. You're like, okay, this is a nice song. I'm going to go. For me, my favorites on this album are definitely Why Me.
You don't like Lights?
I have to re-familiar myself with that. And Borrow Time. These are my two favorites. Oh, and The First Time. Yeah. I like The First Time miles above Babe.
Okay.
Okay. But for me, the song, I said there were lyrics that haunted me. And I believe it's the beginning of Borrow Time.
Borrow Time.
And the lyrics are, in the very beginning of the song, the drums are picking up,
right,
and it
goes,
don't look now, but here come the 80s.
Right.
And it's now 2018. And it feels like I heard that album when it first came out, and it was 1979, and it was Don't Look Now, but here come the 80s, and the 80s are gone, the 90s are gone.
I have my notes.
Yeah. The 90s are going, the 2000s are going, and we are almost past whatever these are. Yeah. We're approaching the roaring 20s. Yeah. So
this album was probably released at towards the end of 79, probably, for him to put a lyric in like that.
Yeah.
You know?
Yep. So, all right, cool. Let's, what do we have up next? We're going to the Blast, Trash, and Fix.
That should be very interesting.
Yes, it should. So now we do our Blast, Trash, and Fix. First, I want to say hi, Lynn Finn.
How
don't
you doing?
Worry, you didn't vote. Hope everything went well tonight at the salon. I cover everything here.
Okay.
It's like,
hey.
I stalk our fans.
How
That's
do you know
she
was at the salon?
Because I'm a stalker. Okay. I know what everybody's done.
Well, okay.
Yes.
All right, so
they hate me for Van Halen. Hey.
They're going to hate you even more when they see what our top three is. Are you ready? You ready to show them what number three is? Really?
Number three.
Really? Okay.
This album sold.
I don't care how much it sold.
8 million worldwide.
Okay, good.
Supertramp. Breakfast in America.
And people, this beat out Van Halen 2.
Sometimes, you know, depends upon the album. It wouldn't beat out Van Halen 1. Make sure they see that. Oh, they got the price tag still on that.
Yeah, the price tag still on.
So.
I have nothing to say about this. I mean, it's like.
Are you protesting?
It shouldn't be here. It shouldn't be here. So when they say, let's see, what songs came off of here? The Logical song was good. Goodbye Stranger was good. Breakfast in America was good. Take the Long Way Home was good. Just Another Nervous Wreck was a song that I kind of liked that I wasn't familiar with. Okay, you agree with me there?
Yeah.
All right, so I do listen to this stuff.
Right.
I just don't totally like, you know, you pick an album and I'm like, oh, well, I'm just totally ignore it without going and actually listening to it to see if my opinion changed at all. There's some good songs on here, but it's Supertramp. And, you know, it probably belongs in the top 10 somewhere, probably lower on the list, but not in the top three and not. You know, not above Van Halen's second album. I'm sorry. So go ahead.
Okay.
State your case.
Hey, so, you know, what can like 9 million worldwide sales do for an album?
Okay.
It's a great album.
All right.
Going Hollywood. I'm going to do the non-hits that you didn't approve. Going Hollywood's a good song. Oh, Darling. Lord Is in Mine, Another Nervous Wreck. It's just a great album. And I mean, the hits. Everybody knows the Logical song. Everybody knows Goodbye Stranger.
Right.
And everybody knows Breakfast in America. These are three staples that are out there.
Okay.
So for me, this was a great album that...
Yeah, it was a good album.
I like
get
it
me
even
wrong.
More the fact that it's pissing you off that
don't,
it's in a top
don't get me wrong. There's ten tracks on here. I think five or six are really good. But the Van Halen album, every freaking track on there was kicked ass.
Scott, you're right. He says, Len, you need to appreciate keyboards.
I do appreciate the keyboard piano. I love Billy Joel. I love Elton John. But this compared to... See, what I'm trying to do, Scott, is to compare it to what came out in 1979. Based on that fact...
Van Halen would have been 12th on my list.
That this album just doesn't belong this high. For me, anyway. Sorry.
Hey.
So what came in at number two? Let's move on.
Oh, it's always about number two.
Number two. That's more like it now.
The Cars, Candy Out.
Ben, where are you, Ben?
Well, don't try to like act like, you know, like you're the reason.
Well, I actually had this at number three, Ed. I will admit, I had
this. I actually had this at number three, Lenny. So, next point.
Well, how did this come in number two,
Ben? Because we had stuff higher. Did I add wrong this week?
I don't know. Who knows? I think he's making it work out to his benefit here.
I just like the ladies on the cover.
Okay, yeah, that's right.
You got her there as a young girl, and her there
as an older waitress, finishing out her life. Yeah, okay. There you go, Ben Powell. Yeah, baby. Ben, you want a Candy L up there this week? And I promised you that I'd try to do it, and it's up here. It's number two.
Oh, it's all him.
It's number two. So anyway, let's go over the tracks of this album. We're going to do a Blast, Trash, and Fix of the top three. So, but anyway. Let's go. Since I Held You, It's All I Can Do, Double Life, Candy O, Night Spots, Got a Lot on My Head, Dangerous Type, or just a few of the really good songs that came off this album. Now, I have to say that I think this is a slightly below their debut album, Ed, but not by much. You know, for me, you know, as an album as a whole, I think their first album was just a tad stronger than this one.
I actually like this album better, and it's not that I dissed
I see the first tad. A tad. It's close for me, but
I think because there's more songs on here that kick. And
now, like songs like there's like two songs in here that were okay for me. You Can't Hold On Too Long and Lust for Kicks. Now, I think there was only one song off the first album that was kind of weak for me. So
well,
that's
we're going tit
that
for
kind
tat
of
there.
Yeah, tit for tat. So that kind of like makes number one a little bit attached.
But
over.
I think Candia was a great rockin' song.
Yes.
All I Can Do is a great song. And I really love, well, I love Shooby-Doo, which tied into Candia.
Right, yeah, that just goes in. Yeah, right. That's like a little instrumental kind of thing.
Yeah. Oh, look, it's a band from Boston. The Patriots don't play in Boston, Ben. The Patriots play in Foxborough. Okay, find a Foxborough rock band. Okay, I know what you're going at. It ain't working with me.
Did Boston come from Boston? Aerosmith came from Boston, right?
Well, actually, Son of Pete, New Hampshire, but
okay, they claim Boston, whatever.
Yeah, well, they all do.
It's okay, like, so of course, everybody knows what the number one album. All you sheeple,
no surprise.
All you freaking sheeple,
no surprise.
No surprise. It's The Wall by Pink Floyd.
Yeah.
Greatest album of all time. Oh, wait a minute. Animals was. Oh, wait a minute. Dark Side of the Moon was. Oh, I'm sorry. Okay.
This is going to be interesting. And I think it's going to be interesting for many reasons.
Okay. Why do you say it's going to be interesting?
Go on. Do your
go on what? Oh, you want me to go first?
Yes, I do.
Well, I know which one you're picking first, so I mean, no freaking surprise. Okay. All right. Blast, Trash, and Fix. Okay, so right off the bat, would you like to hear who I dumped out of these three?
Can I guess?
Yeah, sure you can. Supertramp.
I'll take Supertramp.
That's going out. That's out. It doesn't belong in the top three. I'm sorry. I wish Van Halen 2 was here. Like I keep on saying it. It would have been a harder decision for me, but that was easy. Supertramp is out. Okay, I am fixing The Wall. I'm fixing The Wall. Now, I have to say that The Wall by Pink Floyd is one of my favorite Pink Floyd albums, Ed.
Mm-hmm.
But I think it's a double album, and I think it just was too long. It's an album that I thought the way I would fix it, I would make it a single album, right? Mm-hmm. I would take In the Flesh, Another Brick in the Wall, Mother, Young Lust, Hey You, Is There Anybody Out There, and Run Like Hell. And just take those songs and make this a single album. There's a lot of filler in here. What I like about this album is there's not really a lot of long songs in here. There's a lot of 3, 4, 2, you know, as far as that goes, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So, as you're going through the album, there's like a little bit, you know, you get a little bit of this and a little bit of that, which I like. They didn't go through a 10 or 15 minute kind of friggin' song, you know. So that's what I like about this, but there's just too much filler in here for me. You know, so like I said, that I would fix this and make this a single, and with the songs that I mentioned out of here, and of course I'm blasting Candio by the Cars out of these three because you know, like I explained when we first talked about this album, there's a lot of strong songs on here, and I just like this type of music better than Pink Floyd's type of music. It's just a matter of opinion for me. But I prefer The Cars over The Wall. So I would blast Candio, I would fix The Wall, and I would dump Supertramp. So go ahead, Ed.
You ready?
Yeah, you're wrong, yeah. Lenny, you ignorant slut.
So when I vote for the albums, you vote for them, and there are things that just trigger in your head, and it's like boom, boom, boom. Then you analyze. After we vote, after we put our albums together, and this is the list.
So anyway, Kevin said a lot of people feel that way about The Wall, Lenny.
So.
Okay.
So, that being said.
I'm sorry, I just totally blanked you out.
No, you did not blank me.
I blanked you out.
No,
what were you saying?
You did not
what
blank
was your
me
intro
out.
into your Trash and Fix?
You did not blank me out.
I did blank you out because I was trying to look at the... Mike said I did a good job. Thank you. Linda's on Team Ed. Well, of course. Yeah, okay.
Well, here we go.
Ben Powell said, "I'm the man." Of course, I'm the man because I blasted Candy O.
You guys don't know
that.
What I'm about to do.
Okay. So, what are you dumping the wall?
I am dumping.
Wow. You are dumping the wall. At any string, you're dumping the wall?
And I'll tell you,
wow.
Basically for the same reason.
And I know who you're blasting now. Because I know who you're blasting.
I'm blasting the cars.
No, oh, I thought you were going to blast Supertramp.
I'm fixing that.
Oh, okay. My man.
Okay. So, you probably
should. So we're not too far off on this then.
I look at the wall as putting it together as a single album.
Yeah, okay.
This would be right there with
tremendous.
Dark Side of the Moon.
This would be a tremendous
and
album.
Animals.
This probably would be their best album if they put it
here's
as a single.
The thing. I looked at this. Another Brick in the Wall Part 1. Okay, cool. But what we got another Brick in the Wall Part 2.
And then a Part 3.
And a Part 3.
Right.
We've got Empty Space. There's a lot of songs
in here. A lot of Empty Space.
That's filler.
Right, exactly.
Now, don't get me wrong.
Thank you.
The concept of the album was great.
Yes.
And it was Pink Floyd.
But there's 24 tracks on here. My God.
This would not be...
Holy crap.
And anybody that
26.
Has... 26. Right. And anybody that has an argument with me about the wall... When was the last time you put the wall on from track
like
one?
It's like 80 minutes worth of music
to the end and listen to it for.
Right.
It's not. And again, this is an album. I voted high for it. I did. I put it at my number one because I know it seems hypocritical. But I vote because you vote on what you recall. And then when I'm looking at it, I'm like.
I had this at number four.
It's not my favorite Pink Floyd album. My favorite Pink Floyd album, as well known, documented, is Animals. Okay? This is probably my
favorite's Wish You Were Here.
Right, so what I have Animals, Dark Side of the Moon, the Division Bell, which was the last album they released, and then
in one of
Wish
our
You Were Here.
Last season, didn't we pit three Pink Floyd albums against one another?
Yeah. So for me, I'm blasting the Cars Candio, and I'm fixing Supertramp's Breakfast in America. I'm taking out some of the stuff and bringing
which don't even belong in our top three.
I'm bringing a couple songs from
that should have been dumped.
Well,
I mean, we agree on the blast, which is very uncommon for us. We normally don't do that, but I'm very surprised that you're dumping the wall and fixing Supertramp. That I'm shocked over.
Okay, I like Kevin saying he goes, I love the whole thing, but I completely understand your point. It's it's not that it's not a great album. The concept is good. It's a good concept. So the songs that are kind of weak fit a Broadway play kind of story type
right.
of thing. But there's songs
But there's a lot of filler, but the filler, I mean, the only thing that has it going for it is that the filler isn't that long. There's 2 minutes here, 1:30 here, 2.5 minutes here, you know what I mean? Which, you know, then you go into something else.
Right. Right. So now let's move on to the next segment, where I'm going to talk about some interesting albums. As we were in 1979, music started changing, and there were all kinds of different genres, and you know, I mean, to me, it was all music. It was all rock music, whatever category you put on it. But yes, there were things that you could tell the difference. And I'm doing this segment by myself because I don't think this was really... Most of these weren't Lenny's cup of tea, and that's cool. And maybe a lot of you, it's not your cup of tea. Maybe it's like one album that I mentioned here, one album there. I always like to explore all the boundaries of music and kind of, and that's not making me better for doing that. It's just, I just love music, and I can just about cover everything except for like real old-fashioned country music. Anyway, that being said, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to put up some albums here that is new wave, punk, whatever the movement was that was starting to happen, it was starting to really kick in 1979. And I won't call this as much punk because I'll do that in two episodes from now when we cover a lot of the genres and everything from the 70s. So the first album I'm going to put up here, I'm not going to talk too much about it, was a band called The Specials. Now, they really got me into like a ska kind of thing, and I really liked it. It was different. It was a different sound. Now, you could say that the Police kind of had like a reggae kind of thing, but really the ska sound was really first done by The Specials, which to me, even though when I looked at their wiki today, the Mighty Mighty Boss Tones, it didn't list The Specials down there, but it sure looks like when the Boss Tones were kind of like starting, that I kind of personally think that the Specials had to be a major influence on them. My favorite song on this album is a song called Too Much Too Young. And again, go check it out. Even just check out that song, Too Much Too Young. It's a good little tune. Next up here on the albums that are a little bit more obscure, a band named XTC. Okay, this album's called Drums and Wires. Now, XTC, Andy Partridge is a great songwriter. It's more, I find myself, I listened to it a lot back then, but I like it even more now. It's a more, you just appreciate the songs because, you know, as we're growing up, there's only so much you can buy each week of albums, I mean, because we didn't have the money. But XTC, and my favorite song off of this is a song called We're Looking Out for Nigel. And really, it's kind of a silly song, but that's what made it fun. It was quirky and it was good. It's amazing that, well, we won't get into other songs from other albums, so we'll move on to the next one. So here, coming up next is Blondie, who was kind of like, from the CBGB's area, kind of like a punk thing, but I think more developed in a new wave, where I think new wave was more of a poppy punk. How those genres came about, you do accept what band's what, but the terminology was kind of like, well, is this band punk or is this band new wave? Oh, wait, they're fun. Oh, they're new wave. Oh, they're angry. They're punk. Blondie, and this album was a good one. This followed up by Parallel Lines and a couple others. This was Eat to the Beat, and this had Dreaming on it, which is a great song, Union City Blues, and my favorite one is Die Young, Stay Pretty. It was her fourth album. It peaked at number 17 on the charts. It went to number one on the UK charts, and it's sold over a million, possibly, yeah, about a million copies. Next up, we have a band called The Talking Heads. Now, in the prior to shows we did Talking Heads' first one, and I think that had Psycho Killer on it. When that came out, everybody was like, especially like a lot of my musician friends were like, kind of like, what is this? This is weird. This is strange. And the song still grew on you, but it just didn't grow enough on you to say, hey, I like this whole band as a whole. Then it came out with Take Me to the River. Now, all those little rockers, we liked Foghat's version of that song. It's an old blues song, but Take Me to the River. Foghat just kicked ass, and again, it was a strange and quirky song. But when this album came out, they had the one song on here, Life During Wartime, and that's when the catchphrase, it went all over the country. Everybody's saying, you know, this ain't no party, this ain't no disco, this ain't no fooling around. And like, everybody knew that line from this song. And this song kind of put the Talking Heads, it's kind of a staple. Now the weird thing was, as we moved into the 80s with the Talking Heads, there seemed like their music was on MTV constantly and being played on the radio, and they were really good songs, and we liked them, Burning Down the House and Go On and On. But when I looked at their album sales, they didn't really peak, and they peaked at like a million, and that's still a good number. But you would have thought that, I even thought like their greatest hits compilation would have sold several million, because it had everything you needed by them. So I was kind of surprised to see that the album sales were not as big as I thought, based on how all over the place the band moved, like in the early 80s. So, next up is Graham Parker and The Rumor, Squeezing Out Sparks. Now, I was fortunate in 1979 to see Graham Parker and The Rumor touring on this album as an opening act for Cheap Trick, who was touring for the Budokan album. This is a great album. It's got Discovering Japan, Local Girls, and Nobody Hurts You, Harder Than Yourself. This is a great pop album, and a lot of Graham Parker stuff is good. I mean, Graham Parker was kind of like, really, like, the attitude was punk, the songs were pop. It was kind of like, you know, again, and there was just so many subgenres that came out. It's just like, it was a good album, and it was a great band live. So, next up are the B-52s. When the B-52s came out with Rock Lobster, especially when they were on Saturday Night Live, I think every one of my musician friends wanted to just throw up and die. It was like, what is this crap? And at first, I took offense to it, too. At first, I was kind of like, oh, this isn't pure. This isn't wild. Look at what they're doing there. It's kind of, you know, just really dumb. And one of my buddies just said, hey, lighten up. It's fun. And you know what? I lightened up and didn't take it so seriously. And it's a great album, and it's fun, and I'm sorry. If you had never done the Rock Lobster, you haven't lived. I know a regular viewer on this show who's actually laid on their back in a casino doing the Rock Lobster. But we'll keep that silent. Maybe they're watching tonight, maybe they're not. But also had Planet Claire on here and 52 Girls. But again, a great album, and it's just fun, and it's just so strangely bizarre. And they worked that. They worked that. That music that they did. So next up, we have The Clash, London Calling. Now, this was in my top 10 this week that didn't make it, and that's why I didn't talk about my top 10 that didn't make it. The Clash, London Calling, it's weird on this album, because this album is like, it's labeled punk, but I really think the first two Clash albums were more punk than this. This covered like all kinds of styles. It covered, you know, as it says here, rockabilly, reggae, ska, New Orleans R&B, pop, lounge jazz, hard rock. And one of the biggest hits on this album, Train in Vain, was not going to be on this album. It actually was going to be a free giveaway. And at the last minute, the deal that they were doing with NME, I think it was, New Music Exchange, fell through. And so at the last minute, they threw it as a hidden track on the album. So if you ever look, because I remember going through and everybody saying this is on London Calling, and you didn't see it on the track listing. But then you notice, I think it was like side four had like four songs listed and there were five grooves, and you're like, maybe this is it. But my favorites off of this, I mean, you have London Calling, Brand New Cadillac, you have Jimmy Jazz, Spanish Bombs, really good stuff. And again, for me, I kind of look at this album, and you look at the attitude of the album cover, which is another thing. The album cover is a takeoff of this Elvis Presley album, and it was done intentionally. It was sort of like saying, I think what I read was like, this is where Elvis was declaring himself as the king of rock and roll, and the Clash were kind of like, in a subtle way, declaring themselves the king of like the new movement. So I guess we could say punk. but yeah, London Calling, great album. Now, that takes us, for a final segue here, to another Elvis, Elvis Costello. Well, Elvis Costello's first two solo albums, My Aim is True, and oh God, shit. Anyway, the first two albums. I didn't have those notes because I didn't think I was going to say anything about it. But the first two albums had some good songs on them. This album, if I'm going to turn anybody on Elvis Costello, I'm going to say, get this album. Because you had Accidents Will Happen, What's So Funny About Peace, Love, and Understanding. I enjoyed songs like Senior Service, Oliver's Army, Busy Bodies, and I have to say, and Two Little Hitlers. And of course, I think one of the most underrated songs on this album is a song called Goon Squad. So I think that's enough of me for now. We're going to get back to the live portion of the show. This is where we're able to take a little break. But I still want to talk about these albums, and I'm glad you listened, and I will see you soon. Back to the live show.
Well, thanks for that break. I really needed it.
Yeah, so I want to talk about some albums that... And I'm reading the comments that, The Clash, that's kind of redefined music. It went everywhere. It's just, and what else do we have here? Well, Local Girls, I saw Graham Parker open up for Cheap Trick on the Budokan tour. And, I mean, what a great show. It was just like, you know, and aside from that album, Graham Parker had Mercury Poison was a big hit.
Okay.
Which was actually about his record label. That was on an album prior.
Mm-hmm.
And then came up with an album called Stupid Faction, which has some hits on it too.
Okay.
But yeah, so let's see here. So yeah, just wanted to give everybody a little bit off the beaten trail, because I know if it's not Dennis DeYoung, Steve Perry, or Paul Stanley, he would not get it. So I'm here for you to just broaden your horizons just a tad.
Yeah, okay. You're here for us to put Super Tramp in the top three instead of
He's still holding a grudge. Still holding a grudge.
So anyway.
So yeah, let me move this over here.
We have 10 more albums we'd like to talk about from 1979.
And that's the rest of the Super Tramp discography, as
yes.
a matter of fact.
So Ed, you're on your own. Another break for me.
Okay, so let's... I'm not sure the... all right, so... So here, we're doing this part here. It's like, these are 10 more albums that I think you should know about, or we got something to say about them. And I'm just going to start off with the first one here. Molly Hatchet, Flirting with Disaster. Well, that's because there's going to be a lot of them across the bottom.
Okay, gotcha.
So Molly Hatchet, Flirting with Disaster, first off, it sold 2 million copies. I think one of the main reasons why they
the
were
good
signed...
Times Roll, is that the car song?
Yeah, yeah.
It's a track off the album.
This was a really good album. The problem I always found with Molly Hatchet, like going forward after this, was everything started to kind of sound the same. But this was a great album. It rocked.
Yeah,
it
Molly
was kind of filling.
Good.
Molly
they
Hatchet
like a
was kind of
southern rock.
Well,
they were.
They were kind of filling the void because Lynyrd Skynyrd went down in the plane crash like the year before.
Mm-hmm.
So, I say that this album, and they had the kind of these cool album covers. The first album got your attention, but this album really kept you. But as you found out going forward, things, in my opinion, started sounding the same. But if I'm going to say, hey, listen to a Molly Hatchet album, good Southern Rock, this is definitely in that realm.
Okay.
So let's see here. Okay. Ian Hunter, Never Alone with a Schizophrenic. Okay, for some of you out there who don't know who Ian Hunter is,
I probably
should smack you down. But this album here, from start to finish, just kicks ass. Okay? The Just Another Night, great, but the Cleveland Rocks, which is the That 70s Show.
I actually own.
Right, is it?
No, it was...
No,
Drew
Carey. Drew
Carey, yeah.
Drew Carey Show, Cleveland Rocks, right. The That 70s Show was Cheap Trick.
I actually have an Ian Hunter album in my possession. I forget which one it is. It's not this one.
Cool. And it's a great album title, too. You're Never Alone with the Schizophrenic.
Yeah.
But here's the interesting point of this album, okay? Well, first off, this album, and we're going to have a Bruce Springsteen mention here.
You're doing it, not me.
Yes.
Okay.
Most of the musicians on this album were Bruce Springsteen's...
Oh. Springsteen.
Somebody has to do a shot.
Springsteen.
Yeah. His backup band. It was...
What, from the E Street?
Yeah. Roy Benton, Max Weinberg, Gary Talent.
Wow.
But Mick Ronson also played on this album, and Eric Bloom from Blue Oyster Cult.
Okay.
So, Never Alone with a Schizophrenic, it's a great album. It just rocks from start to finish. It's old school. It could have been a Mötley Crüe album, and it's really good. So, let's go on to the next one here. Blackfoot Strikes. Okay. So, I was kind of surprised that this album didn't at least go gold. This is one that I will play some stuff for you
at a different time. I'm not familiar with this one.
It's really good. They do a couple covers. They do a free cover called Wishing Well. They do a great version of I Got a Line on You, which is Randy California Spirit.
Right. Got a line on you.
This album is just solid. Now, the main person in this album is Ricky Medlock, who was one of the original members of Lynyrd Skynyrd in 1971-72. And then he formed Blackfoot, which was yet another Southern rock type of band. And then now, like present day, he's been with Lynyrd Skynyrd with whatever the version we want to call it.
Gotcha.
But I would definitely recommend Blackfoot Strikes. I was fortunate with Lenny Dramas, if he remembers. Blackfoot was one of the opening acts when we saw Ted Nugent.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. I was so happy because they played a lot of this album. And they really kick butt. So, let's go to the next album. Okay, this album probably should have been in the top 10, at least the top 15, and it's the Knack. I mean, the Knack became...
Oh, My Sharona came off of here.
My Sharona came off of here.
What else?
Hold on, let me flip.
That I know. I may be familiar with.
Okay.
Is Frustrated, like...
Frustrated.
Okay.
And Good Girls Don't... Good Girls Don't... But I do. Okay. I don't mean me, like I do.
I understand.
But if,
yeah, right.
If I was a good girl...
Right. You didn't.
Right.
Yeah. But you did.
Your Number, Your Name, Let Me Out.
Excuse me.
It was amazing how, at a brief moment in time, this band was... You know, everybody was always looking for the new Beatles.
Yeah, right.
Always.
Right. This is supposed to be the next Beatles, yeah.
And, well, I never thought it was the next Beatles. I mean, Dave's the one that got
Well, they were promoted as...
Right, because they were young guys. They were foursome. It was the
catchy,
perfect lineup.
Catchy songs. Yeah.
So, one of the interesting things... I mean, this album sold over 2 million copies. So, it's not here by, like, oh, well, just... You know, Ed put it there.
Yeah,
no.
Bill says that I look like I'm at the dentist right now. Yeah, waiting for get a tooth pulled.
I'll be glad to pull a tooth live on there. If anybody wants to say it, you know, maybe we'll do a GoFundMe. It's like, but this sold over 2 million. Now, an interesting...
For you.
Yeah. The interesting thing was the singer Doug Feger, the late Doug Feger... He
you said Sigur, Sigur.
Singer.
You said Sigur, Sigur Dunfiger.
All right, well.
Doug Figger.
All right. Interpret through the all-day IPA, okay?
See, I have to make this interesting for me. I'm sorry. Yeah.
He was the brother of attorney Jeffrey Figger.
Go figure.
Yeah. Jeffrey Figger is later
known. I feel
known,
like Ace Frehley in a Kiss interview.
Look, I'm giving you some fun facts here.
Oh,
Jeffrey
yeah.
Figger is later known for representing Dr. Jack Kevorkian in a series of assisted suicide cases. So, you know, we go from the Knack to death. It's a beautiful segue.
Get the Knack.
So let's... Or get the needle. One or the other.
Get the needle, yeah.
K-N-E-E-D-L-E.
Anyway. I get it.
Okay. So this might be the last of my really, like, kind of obscure ones. This is Dire Straits' Communique. This is Dire Straits' second album. So... When you look at Dire Straits, you look at their first album, Sold as a Swing, and if you really have dug deep, you know that there's Down on the Waterline. Then after this, there's Making Movies, which is my all-time favorite Dire Straits album. And then you have Brother in Arms, which just to me was just too commercial for me. Still good stuff. I think, again, it's one of those cases of that I always argue that it just got played too much.
I'm sorry, did you say something?
Yeah.
Okay.
So, look here. So,
Ben said Telegraph Road.
Right. So the whole thing here with this album is, I was kind of told, because I kind of bypassed this album.
Okay.
I bypassed this album for many years, because you heard nothing off of it. And sometimes we are too, like, well, I didn't hear any hits off of it or whatever. And sometimes they're just albums that don't have hits that's
right.
just really good music. And I had somebody really, literally... Only like 4 years ago, tell me, no, you got to go back and listen to this album.
Okay.
And I did. I'm like, oh, wow. I just bypassed this album. So if anything, if you like Dire Straits and you probably didn't listen to this album, I would say go back. No, there are no hits. No, there's nothing that's going to be familiar to you. It's just a really
go listen to
tasteful,
it anyway.
Nice album.
Okay.
Okay. And I see Ben saying, I saw the Knack in AC with Tommy Two Tone. The Fix and Missing
Ooh,
Persons.
Nice. Nice,
well,
nice. That was a nice show.
Yeah. I mean, Tommy Two Tone was probably the opening act. Probably did a couple songs
the
nobody
and
knew.
Missing, probably just go see The Fix and Missing Persons.
I would go see The Fix. I saw The Fix with the Moody Blues.
Yeah.
They were the opening act, and it was an hour of their greatest hits. It was just good. So anyway, we'll probably talk about The Fix later. So, Scott.
Kinks. No
Scott.
Kinks. Low budget.
Scott.
So I'm assuming
Scott.
That came out.
Now, I couldn't plan that, Scott.
Couldn't plan it.
I could not plan it because I prepare this show during the week. I didn't do any magic since you just posted that.
No, he just waited for somebody to mention, hey, you don't have the Kinks album here? And that's when he pops it up. Just to make it look like. I'm sorry. Yeah.
No, this was in my list because if it wasn't in my list, I wouldn't have notes on the Kinks low budget. Okay. This is where the Kinks kind of went from being like, I always thought of the Kinks as like, they have a lot of good songs. You go back and there's Kinks songs you're like, you didn't know you knew from like the 60s. This is one that took the Kinks to arena rock. Now, the whole thing here is...
Okay, low budget. What else came off here?
Wish I Could Fly Like Superman.
Okay, good song.
Okay, Catch Me Now I'm Falling.
Not
okay?
A good song, yeah.
Yeah. So, and the other tracks are really good stuff. You build it from the... Again, you build it from the hits. That's why I go back to the Dire Straits album and say, no,
yeah, but you build
hits.
It from the hits. There's two hits
but
off of here.
There's three hits. Catch Me Now I'm Falling.
Low budget. Oh, that's right. Three, I'm sorry.
And Wish I Could Fly
Like Superman.
Three hits on a friggin' album. It's like...
Out of 11 songs.
Yeah, so anyway. So, what happened was, Mick Avery said of the album lyrics, Ray's writing was previously too subtle. When we did the big arenas in the late 70s, he was writing harder stuff that would come across. When we signed with Arista, Clive Davis would always talk about getting us into bigger venues, and the music changed, so we get it across in bigger. When we made Low Budget, that was a turning point. The album proved to be a major success in the U.S.
Right, Scott made a comment that this was recorded during a recession, gas crunch, hence the name of the album,
yep.
Low Budget.
Yep, and it got to number 11 in the U.S., okay. The album. So,
now, there were some good songs off of there. Yeah,
yeah, three good songs.
Yeah,
three
very good songs. Yeah.
Yeah.
And for a group, I mean, they originated from the 60s, right?
Yep.
So, and this is 1979.
This was kind of
and they're coming out with this kind of an album in 79.
Well, a couple of episodes ago, I talked about Misfits, mm-hmm. how that was kind of like the beginning of like, okay, here's the one song, and... They had a nice little run in the, like, from the late 70s to, like, 82. But their whole body of work, it's still BAM, I wish I would have seen live. And
right.
There's always talk, Ray Davies, about they're going to get back together, but he wants to put a new album out. Basically, it's not going to mm-hmm. happen. So, let's go to the next album. Oh, You Could Almost Talk Soon.
Of course, Ed puts all his albums first, so...
Well, I did, because I...
So this way, like Bill says, I look like I'm waiting in the dentist office, waiting to get my tooth pulled.
Aside from Apostrophe...
Now, why is he in blackface in this album?
It's just Joe's Garage. It's Frank Zappa, dude.
Okay. I was just curious.
I don't know. I didn't do the homework.
Is this like an Al Jolson album?
Probably, yeah.
Like, okay.
Joe's Garage. If I'm going to try to turn anybody on to Frank Zappa, and Bill, you know this is going to happen, and you accepted this already, I am going to play you Joe's Garage, Act 1. Okay? It has the classic songs, Catholic Girls at the CYO.
Okay.
They're learning to blow all the Catholic boys.
Okay.
Crew Slut, Wet T-Shirt Night. Ooh, look at those mammalian protuberances. See, I've learned big words from him.
He's an acquired taste. That's all I have to say.
Why Does It Hurt When I Pee?
Okay, well, you know. Good.
See, there you're getting
it. I mean, that's
fine. You are getting Frank Zappa right there.
No, I'm not getting it. I just laughed at the song title.
I got it from the toilet seat.
I got it from the toilet seat. Okay.
My balls feel like a pair of maracas. I probably got the Gano Kakakakas. I'm telling you.
Okay.
Sure. It's silly lyrics with some really brilliant
music. Yeah,
the
lyrics are nice, but, yeah, okay. Well, like I said, he's an acquired taste.
Oh, that would actually have been a good show. Ian Hunter opening up for the Kinks in 79. That would have covered a couple good albums tonight. So I think we're about eight albums away, Lenny, from you actually having the input. Let's go. This could be a surprise. I don't know.
Led Zeppelin. Is that one of mine? Oh, my God.
In Through the Outdoor.
I'm surprised you didn't mention this. I'm very surprised you didn't have this as a mention.
I have to see a man about a horse over here. Okay. I'll be right back.
But go ahead.
Talk for a second.
So anyway, In Through the Outdoor. This had like many album covers. They had a few, and I believe the album came covered, and they had a few different versions of the album cover just to get people to buy it. You know, just to get maybe every version of it. I'm not exactly sure how many versions this had, but there was a few good songs off of here. In the Evening came off of here, Fool in the Rain, and All My Love. It only had seven tracks. But, you know, I mean, for a Zeppelin album, it wasn't really a strong album, but, you know, this was a 79 release, and I just figured, I mean, it wasn't in my top 10. It's probably in my top 20 somewhere. Okay, so Ben said there was 5 different album covers of this, so that kind of made people want to go out and buy it a couple times, to which was a good marketing ploy. I'm surprised Kiss didn't think of that. You know, so, but it had some good songs. It had seven tracks. It had 3 strong songs on here, kind of like low-key. Fool in the Rain and All My Love are kind of low-key. In the Evening was a really good song by them. I mean, the album as a whole was okay, but, you know, like I said, I probably would have had this in my top 20, Ed. But I'm surprised you didn't have this as a mention, because I know you're a big Zeppelin fan, and
I am mentioning it right here.
Yeah, but I'm mentioning it. This was my input.
No, well, I already had it down. You just.
Oh, okay. Oh, you had it down, but I'm just.
I already had my album list, and I said, "Hey."
Oh, this was part of your album. Okay, I didn't know that. I wasn't aware. Okay.
First off, I graduated high school in June of 1979. My first job out of high school was working at Atco Records, making albums. The beautiful thing about this album is the fact that it was done at where I worked. So I heard this album before everybody did. And I actually took the album and I put it under my shirt and went and left work with it.
Now, were you able to confiscate all 5 versions of the album cover? Were you able to see that?
I probably should have tried to do that, but I don't think I really cared.
Okay.
At the end of each month, we were allowed to buy 5 albums for $1, and there were a lot of old ladies that worked there, and I gave them all $5 and ordered my albums, and then they just dropped them off at my car when they left that day. And by the time I was 21, I had over 1,000 albums in my record collection, and a lot of it had to do with this. And at that time, too, in 1979, my friends didn't get a Genesis or Yes or Led Zeppelin album from me. Mm-hmm. They got the whole catalog.
Right.
Okay. So, that being said, so I took this album to a party. It was a keg party. That's what back in 79.
I remember the story. Yeah. Okay.
And guy came, I said,
I got the new Zeppelin album. And the guy,
I said, I got the new Zeppelin. He's like, yeah. He goes, yeah, I'll get you a case of beer. I'm like, no, yeah. So he goes, all right, I'll go get it. Like, all of a sudden, the party, everybody stopped and were, like, listening to this album. Mm-hmm. And, I mean, I think I was always one that could, like, listen to change in a band. Led Zeppelin purists were freaking horrified by this album. Because there were keyboards in it.
Yeah, it was keyboards. Even though it was John Paul Jones. It was mellow for them.
Yeah.
You know, it was a low-key album kind of thing. Yeah. But it wasn't bad. It wasn't bad.
No. So, let's go on to the next album. Oh! This is Lenny.
This is me. Bad Girls came out in 1979. I know we're kind of a rock theme, kind of.
We're a music theme. Bro.
We're a music theme, but, you know, Donna Summers really doesn't fit in with what we do.
We just lost 12 viewers.
But I had to mention this album. I mean, great vocal. I mean, I seen her live at Resorts, Ed, back in the 70s. Oh my God, she just has an amazing vocal. I mean, I know she's considered the queen of disco, but if you just put that aside for a second.
We do have to use her in the past tense, if I'm not mistaken.
I know. Yeah, she passed away, yes. I think it was 2010 or 2011 she passed away. So anyway, a lot of good hits came off of here. Hot Stuff, Bad Girls, Dim All the Lights, and Sunset People. Now, interesting fact about this album, this was a double album, okay? Which probably another thing should have been a single album. So anyway, Ed, while researching this album, which I did not know, that did you know that Donna Summers was the first artist to have 3 consecutive double albums reach number 1 on the Billboard album charts?
No.
Yes, she came out with Alive and More, and then Bad Girls came out in 79, and then On the Radio, Greatest Hits Volume 1 and 2. 3 consecutive double albums that hit the number one in the Billboard charts.
Scott, I'll address that question when he's done. Go ahead.
Okay. So anyway, that's interesting. There was 3 double albums she came out, consecutive double albums that reached number one on the Billboard charts. So that's why I figured this album, like I said, even though it doesn't fit the theme of our show, the kind of music that we cover, you know, this was a good album, a very popular album. Obviously, it sold a lot of albums, and I'd give it a mention for this year.
Okay, so one thing that now I can't attest for this album being mentioned. This is him, but there's a lot of music off beaten trails that I like too, and I can't argue about her talent or her voice or any of that. But Scott mentioned Donna Summers over Pat Benatar. I would say for this year, yes, because Pat Benatar, her first album had Heartbreaker, and it does have I Need a Lover, which is a John Cougar cover song. But I think when we step into 1980 and go to Crimes of Passion, I think that's when we can start talking about Pat Benatar.
Right.
Heartbreaker's a great song, and it's a good
kickoff. I mean, you know, these albums that were mentioned, it didn't, you know, obviously it didn't make our top 10.
Right. These are just albums we
give it a shout out to.
Right.
You know, I mean, something that, you know, yeah. I owned this album back in 79. Right. I mean, I'm a big rock guy, but right. I like Donna Summer, so.
And Blackfoot Strikes. It's just.
Yeah, right, exactly. It's, you know, right. Just to give it a mention.
Yeah, just other albums that we think, hey, these were interesting. You may have missed it.
Right. And the fact that she had three consecutive double albums that hit number one on the Billboard chart.
Trust me, Communique by Dire Straits, I think a lot of people missed. And I did too. And it wasn't until 2012 where somebody said, no, you got to go back and listen to that album. I was like, oh, this is nice. It's very tasteful guitar playing.
Right.
It's just a good album. So, let's go to the next one. Ah! Fleetwood Mac Tusk.
Oh, that's yours.
Okay. I put this here. I saw them.
That was a decent album.
It was a double album. It's one of those albums.
Double, yeah.
It was. Well, here, let me see. I got the.
I owned this, but I don't know what came off here. Do you have it? Let me see the track listing while you're talking.
The whole thing about this album was I had tickets to see them live at the Spectrum.
Now this followed Rumors, right?
Yeah.
Which was kind of really hard to follow.
Right. Well, the whole thing here was I'm glad you said that. Going into Tusk, Lindsey Buckingham was adamant about creating an album that sounded nothing like Rumors.
Okay.
Despite encouragement from their label, Warner Brothers, who wanted the band to follow up with a commercial record. They didn't want to be behind that album. It was done in a way to undermine just that sort of formula of doing Rumors 2, Rumors 3,
right.
Which is kind of the business model that Warner Brothers would have liked.
But why a double album, though? That's when
I don't know. When this album first came out, I had already had tickets to see Fleetwood Mac on this tour at the Spectrum. And so I bought the album, and I was kind of like, it was kind of rough at first. And this is an album, it's an eclectic, interesting album. I mean, my best song on this album that I particularly like is It's Not That Funny, Is It?, which is a Lindsey Buckingham tune. But Sarah,
Sarah, that's a popular. Yeah.
And I'm
over
not really
and over,
sure.
Maybe.
But it just was.
I've had.
Oh,
this,
and Tusk. Well, Tusk was the same.
Yeah, Tusk.
Too.
Yeah.
And Tusk, I hated until like maybe the past 10 years, where you saw the big bands and everything. It was just.
Yeah, I think I owned the CD and I played it once and I just tossed it aside because I didn't really care for it.
Robin, you're forgiven for coming in late, but you're gonna have to go back, watch the show, and there will be a quiz midweek. Okay. Thank you. So, let's go on to.
Do we have another one?
We have two more.
Two more.
This is probably. I may have threw you a bone here, and it might be. Oh, look at that.
The Babies, Head First. Now, I was always a big fan of the Babies. I loved John Waite's vocal. You know, I mean, this album, it didn't have too much to put it in the top 10. You know, it had Every Time I Think of You, which was a really, really big hit off of here.
Mm-hmm.
Run to Mexico, which is a good song. Head First with the title track was a really good song. And there was another one, Please Don't Leave Me Here, was another good track off of here. I don't think it wasn't their best album, but you know, it was a 79 release, and I don't know how you feel about the Babies. I really like them as a group. And then John Waite went on and did some solo stuff, and then he did stuff with Bad English
with
Neil Sean from Journey and you know, and really good vocal, and I just figured let's mention the Babies this year because they really haven't been mentioned yet. I don't think
there were two bands that in Philly. I think it was WYSP because it was 94 cents and 6 cents sales tax. So they did a concert for two bands at the Tower at two different times, but for $1 at the Tower, you could have saw Dire Straits on their first album, because nobody really knew about them then, and for $1, you could have saw the Babies at the Tower on their first album also, which I believe this was their second or their third.
I don't have it. I don't have the track listing for that. I don't have the discography for that.
Okay.
It wasn't their first. I definitely.
I know it wasn't.
It was probably either second or third. You're right. But I don't think it was a strong. As far as the hits that came off of here, there's only really two strong songs that came out. Every time I think of Human Head first. But you know, I'm sure there's albums that are going to come up later that are probably a little stronger that might make our top ten.
Yeah, let me just go here.
We're just trying to pop up the
Head First was
Head
the
First. Union Jacks was probably a good
third
one.
Album. Yeah.
Yeah.
So I know Vinny and everybody is like, wait a minute. We are an hour and a half into this show.
Yeah, we're getting a lot of thumbs up on that Babies album now, yeah. I tell you. Yeah.
They're yours. No. we're an hour and a half into the show.
As a matter of fact, you're talking about a Babies concert, right? I remember purchasing tickets, believe it or not, at the Spectrum. I don't remember exactly what the year is. I slept out for these tickets. The Babies were supposed to open for Alice Cooper.
Oh wow!
And the show got canceled, and we had to get a refund on I don't know why it got canceled, but I remember.
What year?
I don't remember.
I was going to say,
it had to be late 70s, early 80s kind of thing.
Maybe
it had to do with Alice because he was having problems around that time. But I remember the Babies were opening for Alice Cooper, and I was like, oh, my God, this should be a great concert. And the friggin' thing got canceled on us.
Christoph says, I like the Babies album, but I'll never admit it.
Yeah, you're a closet Babies fan.
Well, yeah. it's because of this.
There's a good chance there's mocking it. Yeah, right, yeah.
So, that being said, everybody's going, wow, we're an hour and 35 minutes into the show, and somebody, mainly this guy, there has not been one mention. And he didn't even use it as brought to you by tonight.
No, I did not.
The last album on our 10 more, and please forgive me. Kiss Dynasty.
Released in 1979. There is a connection here on this, but we'll get into that as I go along the tracks. So this album featured Kiss attempting a disco song, I Was Made for Loving You. Now, I know a lot of groups back in the day, when disco was popular, they came out with some kind of disco sounding. I know the Stones did Miss You.
Right.
Kiss came out with I Was Made for Loving You. I can't really think of other examples off the top of my head. Rod Stewart came out with Do You Think I'm Sexy?
Alice Cooper was in Rehab.
Okay. Alice Cooper's Rehab. Okay. So anyway, I Was Made for Loving You came off here. Ace covered 2000 Man. Mm-hmm. He did the lead, which was a Rolling Stones song.
Blew my story here, but go ahead.
Oh, I'm sorry. What album did that come off of? Was that their Satanic Majesty's Request?
So long story. Back in the day, back in 1979, Lenny got this album. Of course, Lenny, knowing the Stones fan that I am, Lenny's like, Ed, you're not going to believe, Kiss covered a Stones song, he's like, guess which one, and I'm like, well, you guess all the normal ones and everything like that. And when he told me that Kiss covered 2000 Man, which is on their Satanic Majesty's Request, I was quite curious. And I actually like it. I think it's an underrated Stones song.
Yeah. It's a good cover. Sure Know Something came off of here, which was one of my favorites, Magic Touch. But interesting fact about this album, number one, Peter Criss... was in it. Speaking about car accident, we're coming out. Yeah. He was in this car accident. So around that time, Peter Criss was in a car accident, and he couldn't really drum that well. So they had to recruit an African-born studio drummer called Anton Figg to play the drums on all the songs on this album. Okay, and another interesting fact about this. Now, before this album, Ace only sang lead off on one song, was Shock Me off of Love Gun. He actually sung three songs. He did lead on this album, believe it or not. And Gene only sung like two songs off of here, and Peter Criss had a song, but Ace did 2000 Man, X-Ray, and Hard Times, and Save Your Love, which was a really good song. So there were a couple interesting facts on that. I just had to throw it in. I have to throw in something about Kiss on each show.
And this was my opportunity
to do that.
He made you wait to the very end.
To the very end.
God.
So So it's a good album. I mean, they got a little slow, a little disco eaters, a couple of decent songs. Gene has a real good song here called Charisma. Like I said, Save Your Love by Ace. I actually like
Robin, I'll forgive you.
She likes Kiss. All right, my man, my girl, rather. Oh. Excuse me, my girl.
Wait,
a lot of people coming out of the closet tonight.
Wait,
we got Christoph with the babies. Robin Marie with Kiss. My God,
I'm guessing Lenny's talking about my dog, Frankie. You heard Frankie barking.
Right, yeah.
Yeah.
All right. And you're a closet Donny Osmond fan.
No, I'm a closet Barry Manilow fan.
Barry Manilow and Donny Osmond, though, too.
Well, yeah, and the Carpenters.
And the Carpenters, yeah.
Good stuff, man. Right. Good music is good music, man.
So that's it for that album. I don't want to bore anybody with any other.
Oh, you don't want to bore anybody.
No, I don't.
It's a little late for that now. All right, so we're going to go to our Spotify list. This is where we pretend like Spotify was around in 1979. And if we what would your Spotify playlist
we were
be?
We're going to make a playlist.
Of our 10 albums that we...
That we actually picked. Yeah. Not our consensus. Yeah. Okay. So, me, you?
I'll let you go first because I'm a gentleman.
Thank you. So, my number 10 album that I had picked for 79 was Regatta de Blanc, and I had Walking on the Moon, which is one of my favorite Police songs, and I know it's one of yours. I had Breakfast in America at number 9, and I Take the Long Way Home, I picked off of there. That would be my list. Off the Look Sharp album by Joe Jackson, I had One More Time.
Ben, don't give me shit about the Carpenters, man. Karen, man.
Damn the Torpedoes, I had at number 7, and I had Don't Do Me Like That. I had Cornerstone at number 6, which didn't come in our top 10. I had Borrow Time. The Long Run, I had at number 5. I Can't Tell You Why, which was one of my favorite Eagles songs. And actually, that was sung by Timothy Schmidt.
Mm-hmm.
And he doesn't, I believe he probably doesn't do much vocals. It's more Henley and Fry and, you know.
And Joe Walsh sings Joe Walsh songs.
Right. So, but this is a really good slow song that really, I just like it. I got Hey You from the Wall. I had it number 4. Candio off the Candio album. Foreigner, I picked Do What You Like. I just like that. It's a slow song. I love Lou Gramm's vocals on that. And off the Van Halen 2, which I had at number 1, I got DOA, Dead on Arrival, as my number 1 song. So go ahead.
See, I don't really... I just picked the songs and throw them down. I didn't really ever know that we needed to go from our 10th album to our first or whatever. So, pardon my order. I don't know what album, where I had this ranked, but from Cheap Trick...
Wait a minute, Leonard Ramis of Meyer's Kiss.
Yeah, it took him to 50. Yeah, because senility's setting in on the poor guy.
Oh, it took him until he got to 50 to admire Kiss.
Yeah, admire. Admire doesn't
mean... To admire
mean,
them.
Yeah, admire them. You're like, oh, look at them. They look cool. I never would
have listened
to them.
Well, you have to give them some kind of respect, Ed. I mean, they look at all the years they've been around, and they're still drawing fans, and all the albums that they sold over the years.
Paul Stanley's voice is shot.
Right, yeah, he's
and
shot.
And people
are
still coming out.
Okay.
They're
I don't know why.
They're mentally unstable people.
Now, I'm probably one of the biggest fans that you know. Fans that you know.
Yes, because you're even in a Kiss book. You're even in a Paul Stanley Kiss
book. I'm in a Kiss Paul Stanley's from 1989. It's all... So anyway, I wouldn't go see them now because of Paul's voice.
No. I wouldn't go
see
them.
It's shot.
Them. Yeah. All right. And there goes our Kiss argument for the night. So back
but we
to
we agreed.
This.
Something we agreed on. Then.
Yes, we did agree on. Your voice sounded like Paul Stanley right there.
Oh,
yeah. So, for me, if we can finally...
Gotta lose
if
my
we can finally,
if try.
Can it finally be me time?
Go ahead, Ed.
Thank you. It's the Way of the World by Cheap Trick on the Dream Police album. Great song. Caravan. Yeah. You got to listen to this album. You got to listen to these songs.
Caravan. Who's Caravan?
It's Utopia.
Okay. Be specific, please.
Yes.
For people that don't know what you're talking about.
And you know what? I'm going to interrupt and just bend down here. Oh, and...
Don't strain yourself too much.
Yeah. Well, you know what? Another album that didn't get mentioned tonight is... Desolation Angels, thank you. I'll hand them over to you, and you can put them right down there. Okay?
Bad
which,
Company.
Which, actually, I love the song Rock and Roll Fantasy.
Oh, yeah.
Great song.
Gone, Gone, Gone is another good song over here.
So we'll go here. Here's my tour book from the Tusk tour in 1979. There we go, Tusk. Here's my tour book from the Cars Candio tour in 1979.
Which he doesn't never like to see them live. They thought they sucked live, but he saw them 4 times.
So here is that shit team that we're going to beat.
New England.
New England, produced by Paul Stanley. Let's make sure we mention that.
And there's not one good song on here.
I also, in 1979, saw The Who.
Who?
In 1979.
Now, what tour was this off of?
That was the Who Are You tour.
Oh, yeah. It says Summer of 79 right
there
on the bottom.
There
you go.
So, when we did the audience poll this week, you know, not the audience poll, but the group poll, not one of you little fuckers voted for this album. There was, like, no votes. None.
And
you gotta be
the album is?
Dan Fogelberg, Phoenix. Really? Not one vote? I know you're lying. I know you're all in touch with longer than there are fishes in the ocean. I've been in love.
Whoa.
Okay.
It's not use this album to
so
partition.
So this is where he's telling me baby's leaving.
Oh yeah. Cornerstone. We got
Cornerstone.
This. Okay,
there you go. Again, to just show you, this is the vinyl part. Molly Hatchet flirting with disaster. And can you trash this album, please? Really just trash it, or maybe fix it. I don't know. You probably could fix it.
What's the name of this album? There's no
title. It's just bricks on it.
There's no title on it.
There's just bricks on it.
There's another brick.
It looks like there's bricks.
There's a bunch of bricks on the wall. I don't know what this album is, though. It's hard to tell.
Because I know this is going to hurt you. Van Halen.
This is the best Van Halen album ever made. Best one ever made. Van Halen 2.
So, we also have this. You're Never Alone with the Schizophrenic. Great album.
I gotta dig the Ian Hunter album that I have. I don't know which one I have.
Yeah.
Bring it over and show you.
And for Ben Powell.
Candio.
Yes. Candio.
I Need You So.
And Squeezing Out Sparks, Graham Parker and the Rumor.
What's the Rumor?
That's the name of the backup band. Now the funny thing is this is, so I'm glad you said it like that. The band is Graham Parker and the Rumor. Well, the Rumor.
Just the Rumor.
The Rumor.
Not plural.
Wait. Well, the Rumor put out a.
Okay.
Hold on.
Go ahead.
Please,
I'm sorry.
Go ahead. The Rumor put out a solo album around like 78. And the Rumor's solo album was called The Mac.
Okay.
Fleetwood Mac. Rumors.
Rumor. Okay.
The Rumor's
Rumor.
Mac.
Mac. Okay.
Yeah. And right. Last but not least, the album that I'm going to turn everybody on to. Adventures in Utopia, Todd Rundgren and Utopia. Yes.
No.
So, let's finish up my wonderful list here. So, from the Cars.
We're not done yet?
No, we're not done yet. From the Cars, Dangerous Type.
Okay.
Great
good
song.
Yeah, can't argue with that.
Supertramp, Breakfast in America, Gone Hollywood.
Yeah, there's all the good songs off of there.
I think somebody may agree with me. The Police, Walking on the Moon.
That's one thing we agree with.
Yes. Joe Jackson, Sunday Papers. I think my buddy, my new buddy.
Your new buddy.
Scott will agree with me there.
Nah.
Goon Squad, Elvis Costello and the Attractions on Armed Forces. The Clash, from London Calling, Brand New Cadillac. From Pink Floyd, The Wall, Mother,
okay,
and From the Neck, Good Girls.
Not My Sharona?
Don't, no. No. I'm not all about, you're all about the hits, I'm all about the good songs.
Oh, so a hit is not a good song?
Well, a hit could be a good song.
Well, it wouldn't be a hit if it wasn't a good song.
Well, a hit is a song that there's some idiot paying a lot of money.
Yes,
for another
a lot of idiots, though.
Right. And they're just saying, play this song over and over again.
It's got to be a lot of
and
idiots.
And it's just like Stepford.
Song.
It's like, look.
Okay.
Look, you wanna, I'm going to tell you a hit, okay? Loving You is a hit. YMCA is a hit.
Muskrat Love.
Okay. Muskrat Love is a hit, okay? Okay. There you go. Post hoc ergo. It's like,
okay.
Boom.
Yeah.
They're not. It's
right.
Just.
It's like.
So anyway. Do I have a wrap up screen here? No, we don't. So, I want to thank everybody again for watching.
Thank you.
Now, next week is going to be really interesting because it's going to me, after the 70s, I think, it wasn't good anymore because I think technology got so good that live albums became just studio albums
right.
With clapping. So next week, we are going to tackle the great live albums.
Of 1970s.
From 1970s. From 70
right.
to 79.
Right.
And there may have been a few good live albums afterwards, but there I was. Think they're just bands. They're just bands that you might not have even like been a super fan of. They're just live albums, just sounded good. So we're going to cover a whole gamut of albums. We're also going to argue, and I'm also going to do like 30 albums on my own. And
yeah, and I'm just going to like stand here and look like I'm waiting in the dentist office.
There
like
you
Bill
go.
Said. Yeah.
All right. So again,
so you know, thanks for joining us, and you know, we do prepare. Ed has notes. These are all my notes from tonight.
Here's mine.
You know, so
one page.
These are all albums that we just showed you.
Because
you know,
all my notes are up here.
We got
here.
It from the record store right behind us.
Yes.
Here. We just took them out of there.
We got to put them back too.
We got to put them back. Yes, that's right. Yeah, we did.
So that being said,
thank God they have them in alphabetical order, so
yes.
They know where to go.
Oh yeah. Don't even talk to me about alphabetical order. So thank you very much for watching. With our group page, remember you could bring in friends to join. We'll be putting up a poll for live albums. Oh, you know what? I do this every week. Let's
review our poll.
Yeah, let's go here. We still have one little thing, so don't be leaving us yet. Just when you thought you could turn your iPhone off or whatever, now we lure you back in. Our audience poll.
What pray tell was the number one song? Well, what an upset.
Okay.
Let's go from 10 on up.
10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Okay.
And a lot of those albums were
right.
We mentioned.
Right. So
we mentioned
the audience, the group poll that we did on our group page, the number 10 album, as per what you guys voted, was The Long Run.
As per what we voted.
By the Eagles.
We had that at number 10.
Number 9 was
number nine.
Look Sharp.
We had that up there.
Number 8 was Van Halen 2.
That should have been much higher, people.
I think you
very
guys were...
Very disappointed.
Oh, look what album is higher than Van Halen 2 on the group poll. Supertramp, Breakfast in America.
By a lot, too.
Yes, by a lot. Yes. Well, no, by one.
Oh, by one. Oh, by I'm sorry. One. I can't see from here.
So, 10, 9, 8,
I
7.
I don't know.
So, number 6 by the group is Damn the Torpedoes.
Okay, that belongs
Tom
there.
Perry.
Definitely
Tom belong. Perry. Tom Petty.
Whoa.
I know. I'm thinking of Steve. You can't even hand it to me. So,
whoops.
So number 5 on the poll is Ragueta de Blanc
by
the
Police.
Can you
say that 10 times?
Ragueta de Blanc,
oh,
Ragueta de Blanc,
Blanc.
Ragueta de Blanc.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
So number 4 on the poll was Candio by
okay.
the Cars.
All right.
Number 3 on the poll that you guys voted was London Calling.
Which didn't make our top 10.
Made mine.
But it didn't get in our top 10.
No, because you don't have taste. Number 2, now here's a really interesting point.
Yeah, Dynasty by Kiss. That's unreal. That got the number 2.
Highway to Hell by AC/DC.
There was no mention of that.
There was no mention. And I'll explain this. But you didn't mention it either.
I just said there's no mention of it. I said... This
so,
is our show. I mean,
right.
We didn't mention it.
Right. So, now we're going to mention it. And for me, AC/DC, when I was younger, was very much like George Thorogood. As a musician, I just felt it cheap and bleh and all that. And I just wasn't a fan. Then it came out with, you know, then Bon Scott passed and it came out with...
See, I was a fan...
Back in Black.
I was a fan with Bon Scott.
Well,
I liked them with Bon Scott.
I did not hear one... Excuse me. Did any of you hear Lenny say Highway to Hell tonight?
I just said I was a fan.
So.
I said I was a fan of... Now...
Right.
Ed,
but I
Ed,
went back and liked later.
Ed, just because I liked the group... I mean, you know what we're doing here. As a whole, the albums that come out in a particular year, I might like a group, but, you know, based on what came out, there's a lot of... crap that could be higher than what I, you know, not, but doesn't mean I can't like it.
Right.
Right?
So, the number one album by 14 votes over Highway to Hell was Pink Floyd The Wall. But there were some good votes here. The albums that we didn't mention, so another one was Hydra by Toto, which is a really good album.
Yeah, it got like a whole 2 votes.
But look at Dan Fogelberg.
Didn't get any votes.
I put it up there for
you put it there, but you didn't, okay, Shits and Giggles, okay.
Yeah, no. It's really not a bad album, but it's
Kiss Dynasty actually got 4 votes. Wow.
Yeah, well, three of them are your...
My,
You, your daughter.
No. Right, no.
So, yeah. So, anyway, next week we're going to do live albums, and live albums are just going to be...
Just from the 70s.
All over the place.
Right.
And I'm going to do a lot of homework on the live albums.
Well, when Ed texted me that what our theme was for next week, I said, well, just put me down for Kiss Alive 1 through 10, and that'll be my top 10 for the 70s.
Yeah. Sorry. Paul Stanley live, Gene live.
That's right, yeah. Right. Everybody live, yeah.
Yeah. So, no, I mean, AC/DC, at the time, I wasn't into them. I went back, and I like a lot. I love AC/DC. It just becomes... It kind of comes from me, because I was a musician. And Lenny Tramas, you're going to attest to this. Lenny hated the Police. He thought they were cheap and stupid. And then one day he sat down to learn one of their songs, and he came back and he was like, holy shit, this is like, you know, it's just a doom doom doom.
Right.
You know?
I mean, so, I remember talking about the Police. I mean, I remember when Roxanne came out. I was in a club. There's a club that I frequent back in the day, mm-hmm. T-Zodiacs, and the song came on over the you know, right. whatever. And I was like, oh, wow, this is a pretty good song. And they used to play it every weekend. Okay, so, all right, the Police. So, you know, I never actually went out and purchased any of their CDs or albums or anything like that. But then, you know, the rock shows that came on back in the day, I don't know, it was Midnight Special or...
In Concert, right.
Concert or whatever. Yeah. So anyway, I think they actually showed a whole concert of the Police one night.
Right.
And I was there and I watched it, and I was amazed at how many great songs they had.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, oh my God, they were just like one right after another, boom, 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 boom. And I was like, and that's when it hit me, I was like, wow. These guys are good.
Oh, yeah.
You know, and that's when it hit me. You know, and then it's when I really started getting into
it. Right. So there's a lot of bands we miss. I mean, because, you know, there's only two of us, and there's so many albums, so little time. So we're going to come back in different ways and revisit a lot of stuff we missed, and eventually...
This way, Ed can do like 10 shows in a row of all obscure shit that he likes, and it gives me a little bit of a break.
So it's the end of the night, and it's your voting that counts right now. Is it... Team Ed?
Oh, would you stop?
Or is it Team Lenny?
Len, yeah. You remember my name. Wow.
So, please, make your votes count for Team Ed or Team Lenny. And we will see you next week when we talk about our favorite live albums of the 70s.
70s, right.
But we're going to go all over the place. It's going to be fun because there's a lot of bands who... Maybe not sold millions upon millions of albums, but their live albums are really freaking good.
And we might even get into some bootleg stuff, too.
That's definitely going to happen.
Yeah.
So, thank you again for watching. See you next Friday night. And don't forget, share the video.
Yeah, and don't forget, vote for Len.
No, vote for Ed. No, seriously, vote for Ed.
Yeah.
Really. Or I will ban you from the group.
So bad.